Say, Cat, it's 4 o'clock in the morning. I just left the Death Studios. Here we are in Harlem. Everybody's here but the police, and they'll be here any minute. It's high time. So catch this song. Here it is. Say, I dreamed about a reefer 5 feet long. A mighty man, but not too strong. You'll be high, but not for long. If you're a viper.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the new Viper Hour. I'm your host, Radical Russ Belleville, bringing you another hour of reefer jazz era music. Tonight, we're going to be focusing on the Prohibition decade, the 1920s, also known as the Roaring Twenties. We'll start all the way back in 1921 with the comedic stylings of Byron G. Harlan, followed up by Emil Coleman and his orchestra. We've got other orchestras as well. Eddie Elkins Orchestra, Dave Harmon Orchestra, Cole McElroy's Spanish Ballroom Orchestra, and many, many more. But this is Thanksgiving week here in the United States, so we're actually going to open the show with some Thanksgiving favorites. We've got some real old recordings that we picked up from archive.org. Great source of this,
I didn't know you cared.
Of this legendary music.
That's enough now. Wait a minute.
Some of these go back to the old cylinder recordings, predating discs. All the way back to the Victrola era for one of our songs, A Song of Thanksgiving, which comes to us from 1912. But to open the show today, you know, I can't think of Thanksgiving without thinking of the annual tradition on television of watching the Charlie Brown Thanksgiving special. And with that in mind, we give you the Vince Guaraldi Trio with Linus and Lucy.
Thank you. clear through the grief and slime. With a golden joy in a silver mart. Thank God for and above the whole world through. Oh, my love, my life, oh, my life and love. Thank God for you.
Charles Hackett with A Song of Thanksgiving from 1912, a 101-year-old song on the old cylinders they would play on the Victrolas there. And before that, the Vince Guaraldi Trio with the classic Linus and Lucy, the song everyone knows as the Charlie Brown song. You're listening to the new Viper Hour. I'm Radical Russ Belville, and today we're going to take you into the music of the 1920s. The decade of prohibition, and these songs do not necessarily have anything to do with marijuana or drinking at all. These are just some of the songs that were playing in popular rotation at the time to give you a feel for the flavor of what was going on in the roaring 20s. We're going to open up with a couple of artists that were known for their tongue-in-cheek acts. In fact, this first one, Byron G. Harlan, couple of songs from 1921 and 1922. He was part of a duo known as Collins and Harlan, and one of their tunes from 1916 called That Funny Jazz Band from Dixieland was one of the first recorded uses of the word jazz, J-A-S, which evolved into J-A-S-S, which then eventually became what we know it today as jazz. Now, the music they played at the time would be very controversial today. It was what was called, and forgive me for saying it, coon songs, music sung by white performers in black dialect. So some of this would be quite offensive by today's standards, but this was what was happening at the time, and I feel this gives us a accurate representation of the feelings and flavors of the 1920s. So we're going to open up with Byron G. Harlan and his version of I Ain't Nobody's Darling from 1921, followed by Uncle Josh Buys an Automobile from 1922. Then we'll have two songs from Emil Colvin and his Montmartre Orchestra.
I went to see my darling that Saturday night. I went to see my darling while the moon was shining bright. I asked her if she'd marry me, and what do you think she said? She said she wouldn't marry me if the rest of the world was dead. part of me if the rest of the world were dead. Now, what do you think of that? And there I have been sparking up to her for nigh unto a year. Took her around quite considerable. Cost a lot of money, too. I tell you, I was more'n upset. Haven't been myself since. And all because I ain't nobody's darling. I'm blue as can be, 'cause I ain't got nobody to make over me. If I don't get somebody, I'd get back to the farm. And if the cows and chickens, 'cause I don't give a good gosh darn. Oh, by Jiminy, my hat. I took my darling walking last Saturday night. I took my darling walking while the moon was shining bright. I asked her for a kiss and she, now what do you think she said? She said she wouldn't kiss me, so I kissed her instead. Gee, what if her eyes told her that time? Gosh, you ought to see her eyes snap. My, but she was mad. Madder than a wet hen. Oh, but I tell you, nothing to laugh at. As I told you before, she said she wouldn't marry me. And by Jiminy, she stuck to it. And now, I ain't nobody's daughter. I'm blue as can be, 'cause I ain't got nobody to make over me. If I don't get somebody, I'll go back to the farm and make love to the chickens, 'cause I don't give a good gosh darn. Oh, by Jiminy, my hat.
Well, sir, I've gone and done it. Yes, sirree, Bob. Nancy nagged at me until I bought an automobile. It come one day last week, and Nancy hadn't been as tickled over anything since her crazy quilt took the prize at the county fair as she was over that joy wagon. Well, sir, I felt it in my bones I'd make a fool of myself, or soon would. So next day I filled it full of gasoline and got all ready to take Nancy, Jim Lawson, and Ezra Hoskins out for a ride. I got out the book of rules, and the more I read it, the less I knew about the innards of that darn machine. Jim said I had to turn the crank to shoot it off. I turned that crank until my eyes stuck out, but it wouldn't budge. Nancy said the bobbin was wound too tight, or else the shutter was threading wrong. By that time, all punk and center were there and giving advice. Like Willie said I ought to talk kindly to it, and offered some oath. Hank Weaver said I ought to leave it around for a spell until it got to know me. And Cy Fittingill said maybe I hadn't watered it yet. And Deacon Witherspoon wanted to offer prayer. Well, sir, I grabbed hold of that crank again, and it flew back and hit me on the shin. And I shot right down in the yard to think it over. And Nancy said the language I used was just shameful. Just then Jim Lawson said, don't this drug go in somewhere? Well, sir, we found where it went, and I turned that crank again. And that machine began to rear and snort. It ran over Hank Weaver's dog, tore a hole through Willett's picket fence, knocked over side fitting hill's beehives, and kept right on a-going. Well, sir, I worked every lever that machine had, and everyone made it go faster. Nancy was a-screaming, Ezra Hoskins was a-praying, and it wouldn't be right to tell what Jim Lawson was doing, but Nancy said he sounded like he was talking to the Lord. And just then we went through Ab Whitaker's wheat field and got it on fire. and I managed to steer it onto the turnpike road, but that didn't help matters any, cause it only hit the road once in a while. It tore down the toll gate, ripped down one side of the covered bridge, and then started off through James Fisher's pasture and killed four sheep and a calf, and then run into a haystack and blowed up. All I've got to show for that joyride is a broken leg, some rubber tires, six lawsuits, and a mortgage on the farm. Nancy said if we ever owned another one, we will have a regular ship in the Akawani. I ain't saying much, but I've got the lingering suspicion that all my joyriding will be done in the old buckboard wagon.
Thank you.
email Coleman and his Montmartre Orchestra with Tomorrow I'll Be in My Dixie Home Again from 1922. And before that, a song you may actually recognize, Toot Toot Tootsie Goodbye, the instrumental, of course, from 1922. It's amazing to think these songs are over 90 years old. Emil Coleman was born in 1892, lived to 1965, and was the suave leader of a society orchestra, much sought after for social galas and debutante balls held at the New York's Waldorf Astoria Hotel in the 1930s. We caught him there early in his career, 1922, with Toot Toot Tootsie Goodbye and Tomorrow I'll Be in My Dixie Home Again. You're listening to the new Viper Hour. I'm Radical Russ Belville, bringing you this music this hour from the 1920s. And speaking of 1922, interesting things occurred 91 years ago, 1922. The British Empire was at its largest extent, covering a quarter of the world and ruling over one in four people on Earth. The President of the United States introduced the first radio in the White House. That was Warren G. Harding in 1922. That was also when, history buffs, you'll recall the Teapot Dome scandal took place, when the United States Secretary of the Interior leased the Teapot Dome oil reserves in Wyoming. In 1922, the Hollywood Bowl first opened for many, many concerts to come after that. In October of 1922, the British Broadcasting Company is formed, BBC. In November of 1922, Egyptology takes the public by storm as Howard Carter and Lord Carnarvon are the first people to enter the tomb of Pharaoh Tutankhamun in over 3,000 years. And that was a very popular fad back in the 1920s. And the USSR first formed at the end of 1922. Now we move on to 1922's Eddie Elkins Orchestra, and the song is Who Cares?
Thank you. other day, sitting right across the way, I heard a fellow say, I'm blue. Lost my gal and I'm in Dutch. I'm to blame, I talk too much. Learn my lesson and I'm not guessing when I'm confessing to you. If you got a girl and you don't want to lose her,
keep it under your hand.
Maybe someone else will be darn glad to choose her.
Keep it under your hand.
Don't tell tales or you'll be pondering where your little feet is wandering. When you're with your gal, just tell her she's 50. But keep it from your pal until she's 50. When you call around and the parlor is cozy,
keep it under your hand.
If you hold her hand and the whole world is rosy,
keep it under your hand.
If you kiss and think you're in heaven, say goodbye to her at 11. But you really leave when the clock's striking 7.
Keep it under your hand.
If you got a girl and you don't want to lose her,
keep it under your hand.
Maybe someone else will be darn glad to choose her.
Keep it under your hand.
Don't tell tales or you'll be pondering where your little feet is wandering. When you're with your gal, just tell her she's nifty. But keep it from your pal until she's 50. When you call around and the parlor is cozy,
keep it under your hand.
If you hold her hand and the whole world is rosy,
keep it under your hand.
If you kiss and think you're in heaven, say goodbye to her at 11.
But you really leave when the clock's striking 7.
Keep it under your hand.
His advice was mighty fine. I've been thinking all the time why many girls are crying too. Like a mason, don't repeat. If you tell each friend you meet, they'll be reaping what you've been keeping and leave you weeping and blue. If you got a man and you don't want to lose him,
keep it under your hand.
Maybe Marianne will be darn glad to choose him.
Keep it under your hand.
In the park or at a movie show where it's dark, your friends will never know if he holds you tight just like you've been wishing. Never let them know when it's intermission. If he likes your pie and he thinks you're the baker,
keep it under your hand.
Though you had to buy, don't let on you're a faker.
Keep it under your hand.
If he says you get all my kisses when you're near me, I know what bliss is.
Though you know he told that to 10 other bitches,
keep it under your hand.
Yes, the original version of Keeping It on the Down Low. That's Robert Denning and his chorus with Keep It Under Your Hat from 1922. Before that, William H. Wright's with the Dill Pickles Rag. An excellent, excellent xylophone solo there. And we opened up with the Eddie Elkins Orchestra with Who Cares? All from 1922. And focusing on that year just for another moment, it was also the year where we saw the formation of the Molly Pitcher Club, which was a women's anti-prohibition organization. They argued that drinking itself was not illegal, and so the government should not get involved with a personal and private choice. And that's something we should all remember from our history books, is that prohibition in America was a nationwide ban on the sale, production, importation, and transportation of alcoholic beverages from 1920 to 1933. Actually drinking or possessing alcohol was not illegal. And this led to people who were actually hoarding alcohol prior to the enactment of the amendment the amendment went into effect January 17th, 1920. And prior to that, people were people of means were hoarding their own personal stashes of beer, liquor, and wine that they were able to consume legally throughout most of the decade of Prohibition. Of course, it was poor people that had to find their way to the speakeasy, some 10,000 of which Al Capone controlled in his Prohibition bootlegging empire that ranged from Chicago to Florida. Of course, the Prohibition was overturned in 1933, with the enactment of the 21st Amendment, America learned its lesson that prohibiting vices creates crime, regulating vices creates revenue. Too bad we can't learn that lesson quicker here in the modern Prohibition. Let's move forward to 1924. This is Clarence Williams with Texas Motor.
up your knees. But listen, people, I want to tell you about a pimp in New Orleans. She's a gal that's always cheerful, even cries when she is cheerful. She got a way of pimping all her own. Her tears would melt a heart of stone. Some sister Sadie's a pimp crybaby from way down New Orleans. Diamond rings, fancy clothes, 5 minutes of them got up all of those. All of her crying is downright lying, for she don't know what trouble means. She can't stop her crying streak. The spirit may be willing, but the flesh is weak. Some sister Sadie, the fam cry baby, from way down New Orleans. Sadie's eyes have caused a lot of wrecks. Sadie's sighs disturb the stronger sex. Sadie's sobs would make a racehorse stop. Her tears would make a cripple lick a traffic cop. Sadie's wise and wins all her bets. Anything she cries for, why, Sadie gets. If a red hot papa comes about, she sheds a lot of tears and he walks right out.
If I'd only believed in you, I wouldn't be wondering who you're giving your kisses to. If I'd only believed in you, I was a fool to listen to the tales that they brought. I learned that they were lies. Oh, what a lesson it's taught. We wouldn't be miles apart. You still would be my sweetheart if I'd only believed in you.
Thank you.
Bert Kaplan and his Collegians with Arthur Fields on vocals with If I'd Only Believed in You from 1926. Before that, the Dave Harmon Orchestra, Sob Sister Sadie, 1925. And with 1924, we gave you Clarence Williams with Texas Moaner. And now that we've fast-forwarded to 1926 in our hour-long look at the 1920s, we are now at the height of Al Capone's power, the Chicago gangster who was made famous and rich by Prohibition. But 1926 was also the year that the NBC radio network was begun and the year that Winnie the Pooh was first published. Interesting year, 1926. And Al Capone was rocked in 1926 on September 20th when members of his rivals, the Northside Gang, shot into his entourage as he was eating lunch at the Hawthorne Hotel restaurant in Chicago. A motorcade of 10 vehicles using Thompson submachine guns and shotguns riddled the outside of the hotel and the restaurant on the first floor of the building. Capone's bodyguard threw him to the ground at the first sound of gunfire, and several bystanders were hurt from flying glass and bullet fragments. Capone paid the medical care for a young boy and his mother who were hurt in the attack. And it was the height of Capone's power and the beginning of the public realizing that the Prohibition was creating this street-level violence that had never been seen in the United States before, with Thompson machine guns and bullets flying and basically the beginning of the drive-by shooting there in 1926. As time goes on, Prohibition tightens and Capone's power grows. When we come back from this next set, we'll tell you how the story ends for Al Capone and Prohibition as we forward you through 1927 with Cole McElroy's Spanish Ballroom Orchestra. This is Honolulu Blues.
Go where punks swing. lady say, come on back, come on back. Oh, I got the Honolulu blues.
Suppose that this could be the weary days, the lonely nights are easy to forget, since I am here and you are here with me. Just we two, here we are,
here we are,
you and I.
Hurry by.
Even while I waited, somehow, dear, I knew.
Somehow I knew.
You'd find me. I'd find you.
Yes, I'd find you.
Here we are. Alone together.
You and I.
What matter where?
We wandered far. So we haven't got a bang for.
We can still be thankful that
here
we are.
we can still be thankful. Here we are.
Here we are.
You and I.
You and I.
Let the world
hurry
by. Even while I waited you, somehow I knew,
dear, I knew
you'd find me, I'd find you. Here we are,
here we are,
alone together. What matter
whether
we wandered far,
though we haven't got a bang for,
we can still be thankful that here we
are. That was Elliot Jacoby and his orchestra with Kashmiri Moon. Before that, Cole McElroy's Spanish Ballroom Orchestra with Honolulu Blues. And Ed Smalley and Jerry Macy, that was the previous song we just heard, excuse me, with Here We Are from 1929. You're listening to the new Viper Hour on 420radio.org. And that last song takes us all the way to the end of our decade, our look at the 1920s. We were telling you about Al Capone and how in 1926, the Northside Gang shot into the Hawthorne Hotel. Well, apparently that was retaliation was taken on 1929 in the famous or infamous St. Valentine's Day massacre in the Lincoln Park neighborhood of Chicago's North Side. The seven victims were killed in a garage on North Clark Street, and the extent of Capone's involvement is widely disputed. No one was ever brought to trial for the crime. The massacre was thought to be Capone's group's effort to strike back at Bugs Moran's Northside Gang. In 1929, the Bureau of Prohibition and Elliot Ness, the Untouchables, you'll remember him, began an investigation of Capone, attempting to get him for prohibition violations, but Frank J. Wilson investigated Capone's income tax violations. The government decided there was a more likely winnable case in tax court. Capone was convicted for these income tax violations in various violations of the Volstead Act or Prohibition in 1931, was sentenced to prison, ended up at Alcatraz Prison. He was paroled in 1939, and after spending a short time in the hospital, returned to his home in Palm Island, Florida. But 20 years of hard living took a toll on him. In 1946, his physician and psychiatrist performed examinations and concluded that Capone, due to brain damage caused by syphilis, had the mental capacity of a 12-year-old child. By 1947, he had a stroke and died shortly after his 48th birthday on January 25th, 1947. Of course, Capone's influence and power was greatly diminished when Prohibition ended in 1933. That's all the time we have here for the new Viper Hour. Thanks for joining us. I'm Radical Russ Belville. We'll do this again next Monday night at 8 p.m. Pacific Time. And until next time, take care of each other, tokers.